just need to take a minute because that was just such a beautiful reading that it just stands on its own. My question to you this morning is, what does it mean to walk in someone else's shoes? Today is the real test for the Eagles to see if they're going to make it to the Super Bowl this year. I guess it's common knowledge that they are playing the Vikings here in Philadelphia. Are there any Vikings fans? Just checking. I wonder what it would be like to walk in the shoes of the Eagles players today. If they're like me, they probably didn't sleep much last night because of the excitement and the anticipation. I almost got in trouble with Bill because he didn't see me wearing any green this morning. Today, they'll be exercising, reviewing their last-minute plays, formations, and strategies. The quarterbacks will be warming up their arms, and the punters will be practicing their kicks. And this evening, football fans will be vicariously walking in the footsteps of the players as they run down the field, aiming for a touchdown. Fans will be calling the plays from their living room easy chairs and their sofas, and if they're lucky enough, like maybe Al, highlights and disappointments until the final victory team wins and heads to the prestigious Super Bowl. So what does all this have to do with today's sermon anyway? Anybody wondering then? No. Well, the players in today's gospel story weren't sitting in their living rooms watching TV, and they weren't at the lake. Al and Russ. You lucky guys. Andrew and Simon were in Galilee, casting their nets out into the sea, trying to catch fish. James and John were in their boat, repairing the holes in their fishing nets. Jesus walks along and he says, "Follow me." As we heard from last week's message from the book of John, our scripture says that Andrew and Simon immediately left their nets and followed Jesus. Are there any football wives here today? Anyone willing to admit? I think I saw Gwen earlier. I didn't know. Is Gwen a football wife? No football wives.
Here I am.
Okay. All right, we've got two that are willing to admit it. There she is. She's a choir wife, too. Right? Can you imagine Jesus coming to your home tonight in the middle of the game, knocks on your door, and asks your husband to follow him? What would happen, Steve? Chair, or you're watching an interesting mystery movie on demand. And if Jesus came knocking on your door, would you immediately get up and follow him? Oh, I see some head nods. All right. What this means is that you're leaving your comfort zone, your regular routine to follow Jesus, and you have no idea where he's going to take you. You know, most likely you're going to be walking in the footsteps of Jesus. For some, this might be a pretty scary proposition. For some, you might think, well, that shoe just doesn't fit. Now this sneaker, if you can imagine, I'm holding a sneaker, maybe from one of the quarterbacks of the Eagles. Maybe that shoe would fit. I can see myself if Doug Peterson asked me to come to Philadelphia and help him coach the Eagles. Jerry, you'd like that, right? Or if the producer of the Pink Panther or James Bond would ask you to be an extra in the show, you could do that, right? Or if James Patterson knocked on your door and asked you to collaborate on his next book, maybe you might even immediately do that. But for those who really know Jesus personally, for those who trust Jesus with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul, you probably wouldn't even give following Jesus a second thought. You would get up immediately, like Andrew and Simon, and follow Jesus. Imagine yourself following in the footsteps of Jesus. You'd be out knocking on doors, proclaiming the good news. You might even be visiting the bars, getting to know the people and sharing the good news with them. You might be in the schools at an assembly, sharing the love of God with children. Believe it or not, there are some people that don't know what the good news is. Yet the good news is so important that we know what the good news is as Christians, and we want the whole world to know it too. It's so important to us that we play our cattle on at noon and at 6 o'clock because we want those familiar hymns to resound throughout Hatfield to remind people that we are a beacon of light in a world of darkness. God's people gather here to worship and to pray, and we have something good to share. That good news is Jesus Christ, who promises us the gift of eternal life. When we call on his name and believe in what he has told us through the Holy Scriptures, the Word of God. And when you say yes to Jesus, I will follow you. The Holy Spirit becomes a part of you, and you automatically want to follow him. You know that the Scriptures are true. There's truth in there, absolute truth. They're not just a bunch of words on a page assembled into a book. They're real. They're alive. Jesus is alive, and he's living in you, and in you, and in you. While we try and prolong our lives on this earth, maybe another 2 years, or 5 years, or 50 years, Jesus says, believe in me, and in return you will live forever in God's kingdom. Death has been dissolved. It has been replaced with eternal life. In 1996, my grandmother, Helen Unger, needed a heart valve replacement. The doctors weren't sure if she was going to survive surgery. But without the surgery, they knew that she would only live probably throughout the week. So she agreed to give it a try. It was something experimental. They were going to replace her heart valve with a pig's heart valve. They informed the family that we should prepare ourselves if she did not make it through the surgery. And if she did, she might live another 2 to 5 years max. They didn't know my grandmother. She made it with flying colors through that surgery. And when she made it past the 5-year mark, she certainly outlived the doctor's expectations. She made it past the 6-year mark and outlived the doctor's and the family's expectations. But someday we knew that she would begin a new life with Jesus. And that life wouldn't be limited to another 2 years or 5 years or 50 years. That new life would last forever. It's more than good news. It's great news. you're needing an office visit with your doctor, like some of you are going to be needing, and the doctor tells you, well, here's the news. You're not going to live another 2 years or 5 years or 50 years. You're going to live forever. And that doctor will be right if you believe in the good news of Jesus Christ. But those who don't, I believe they want to. I believe that deep down inside, most people want to live forever. It's ours for the asking. Follow in Jesus' footsteps. He will take you to a mansion in the sky and provide you with a special room. He will lay out a banquet feast for you, fit for a king. And as I read the scriptures this week, my heart was reading this scripture with the knowledge of my brothers and my sisters here at Heidelberg, filled with the Holy Spirit. And so I read in my mind's eye. As Jesus walked around Hatfield, he saw Al leading the consistory. He saw Sue playing the organ. He saw Ed working on the altar. And Glenn working on the heating system. He saw the choir singing. And he saw people praying. He saw prayer shawls being made. And Sunday school lessons being taught. Put your name in the blank, as I say it, and how you serve the church or your community in the name of Christ. He saw. And finally, as Jesus walked around Hatfield, he saw all of us here worshiping God. How pleased he must be.